another state to now project for Joe Biden. It is going to be the state of Minnesota for Joe Biden. Joe Biden will win the state of Minnesota, and it's 10 electoral votes. It's good timing there. Picking up on what Nate was just saying, I want to bring this to John Carl. We know that President Trump had some hope in Minnesota. He spent a fair amount of time there, spent a fair amount of money there, because he wanted an insurance policy against the loss in Wisconsin or Michigan and Pennsylvania. It's not to be tonight. You combine that with Nebraska, and we're getting a much clearer picture of what each side has to do in these final hours.
Absolutely. I mean, he went there in the last week. He barely lost. Minnesota was the closest state that he could have flipped. And it's one of those blue wall states that he didn't get that he thought he had a chance. So now, you're looking at a situation where he really has to pick off at least Pennsylvania and maybe Pennsylvania plus Michigan or Wisconsin, depending on what happens in Arizona.
Right. And Chris Christie, this goes back to something you were saying before. It's putting even more focus on that state of Pennsylvania, pretty much now, if Joe Biden, assuming Rahm is right about Arizona, if Joe Biden wins the state of Pennsylvania, he's going to win this election.
Yes, the Rahm meter projection makes Pennsylvania. But listen, you and I have been talking about this since July. I have consistently thought that whoever wins Pennsylvania is going to be the next president of the United States. And I think it's shaping up that way. Now, you know, I do think that there's continued encouragement for the president in Wisconsin. And I think he is going to win. I'm going to have the Christie meter. I think he's going to win North Carolina to match up with you on your Arizona prediction and make myself plus four. So you're looking at really Georgia, Pennsylvania, Michigan that I think are still the ones that we have to watch very carefully.
And we're still waiting for Arizona, waiting for Nevada.
And by the way, George, one other thing. I always like to pick out who the biggest loser of the night is. And so far, I think it's Mike Bloomberg. This is a guy who, like, decided to get into this race, thought he was going to be a factor, spent a fortune, was a blip in
Talk
the Democratic
about driving
primary.
Out of your lane to hit the guy.
And now, listen, and now he spends $100 million in Florida, and, you know, Trump's margin is bigger than it was before. So I think anybody who's looking for spare change, go to Mike Bloomberg. He's apparently giving it away for nothing.
See, what is it about Florida? Democrats always seem to be lured down to that state, and it never comes through at the end.
You know, I think the changing demographics, we expect it to look more like what we're seeing in Arizona and Florida, I mean, Arizona and Texas, and it's just not trending that way when you think about black and brown voters, in part because of the heavy conservative vote among Latino voters down there, the growing number of conservative seniors who are moving down and retiring there. I know Biden got a lot more of those than before, but we're just not seeing the trend lines demographically shifting with the party the way we're seeing in places like Arizona and Texas, unfortunately.
Victor Akendo, you're in Miami.
That's right, George. And one Democratic data analyst that we spoke with called what happened in Miami-Dade County a total collapse. And there are some other problems here for Democrats. There's two Democratic House seats that were considered safe in this election. Well, not so much anymore. And one of those belonged to Donna Shalala. And speaking to all the money spent on those television ads, well, they were brutal, just relentless. President Trump hammering Joe Biden, labeling him as a socialist. Well, Republicans only spent, according to the latest numbers that we've seen, about $80 million on those ads, while Democrats spent closer to $130 million. And those ads for Republicans really seem to resonate with those Latino groups, not just Cuban Americans, but it's clear that they also reached the Nicaraguans, the Venezuelans, the Colombians. All of those groups seem to turn out for President Trump in this election, not the way the Democrats wanted this one to go. George?
Somewhat different from the way it's playing in Arizona, but David, what are we seeing in the exit polls about the role race is playing in this election?
Well, if you look at, let's take a look at the question of Minnesota racism in the U.S. It's interesting, if you look here, and given the George Floyd and so much coverage of it this year and this, much needed conversation in this country, only 8% of the people, according to the exit polls, said that that is the most important problem. Of course, we are dealing with the pandemic and the economy, and so there are a lot of things that have also shared the news cycle these last few months. 61%, though, who thought that racism is the most important problem to address went with Joe Biden. If you look in Minnesota, the job performance, he was hoping to pick up this state, but 52% said they disapproved of Donald Trump. And again, that whole debate over containing COVID or rebuilding the economy, this was also a state where well more than 50% said we have to get a handle on the pandemic first.
Lindsay Davis.
I think that what remains to be seen, with the exception of Minnesota, which we just projected, but how the racial politics are playing out, in particular in these flashpoint areas where we saw the majority of the protests and the unrest over the summer during this so-called racial reckoning, in areas like Philadelphia, where we just had the police shooting of Walter Wallace, in Minneapolis with George Floyd, in Atlanta with Rayshard Brooks, and also in Kenosha with Jacob Blake. How is that all going to shake out? Three of those four states still outstanding.
Matthew Dowd, this may have been the subtext of campaigns now going back to, of course, Barack Obama's first win in 2008. We're seeing it play out in different ways every 4 years.
Yeah, and as I said, it's a shifting electoral college, and I'm very interested in seeing what the national popular vote margin ends up, because that's going to tell me a lot. My guess is what we're seeing across all the states, with the huge exception of Florida, which I think at some point the Democrats have to just say, we're never doing that again, that's it, we're done, we'll concentrate somewhere else, is there's about a 3 or 4 point shift towards Biden in every place, percentage-wise, in every place but Florida, Maine, New Hampshire, Arizona, Minnesota, all of the Texas, all of these places you're having a 3 or 4 point shift, and my guess is that is exactly what the national popular vote ends up, that there was a 3 or 4 point shift, and it gave Joe Biden a, we'll see, a bare win in the Electoral College, and that's why everything broke the way it did.
Thank you, Matt. Byron Pitts, I know you want to weigh in on this.
Yeah, George, this issue of how the George Floyd dynamic play, I'm thinking of the famous New York Broadway play, A Bronx Tale. Would you rather be loved or feared, right? What we saw with President Obama, there was so much pride and love for his candidacy in 2008, black voters came out in large numbers. We're not seeing that this time in the South. We were at an evangelical Christian church on Sunday, good and decent people. But when we talked about the issue of the racial divide, almost silence. They didn't have much to say about that conversation. They didn't see it the way that many people of color, many liberals have seen it around the country. And so I think for all the progress we think we're making as a nation, certainly for all the progress people pride themselves on the South, again, this notion of a new South, I think what we're seeing tonight, it would appear, when it comes to race, oftentimes in this nation, blacks and whites can receive the same information, but see it differently.
That's the story of the country. We've seen so many times. We are divided in so many different ways. We have some information now coming in from the state of Nevada. The first votes are coming in from the state of Nevada. So much early vote in that state. It was well over 90% voted before election day, and now 74% of it has been counted.
That's right. That's what we have so far. George, in Clark County, this is where three-fourths of the vote's going to come for the entire state. This, of course, is Las Vegas. Joe Biden with a comfortable lead right there. He's up 10 points, overperforming from 4 years ago. A quarter of the vote still out. You can't talk about Nevada without talking about COVID, George. The state was ravaged by COVID, not only physically, but also economically. At one point, it had the highest unemployment rate in the entire country. 70% of the state depends on tourism. Washoe County, this is Reno. This is where President Trump has to keep the margins close, and right now, they're not that close. So the trend right now, Joe Biden on top in Nevada, and from what we're seeing with the data, a quarter of the vote still out, it looks like it could possibly be good news for Democrats.
Okay, Tom Yamas, thanks very much. Hi, everyone. George Stephanopoulos here. Thanks for checking out the ABC News YouTube channel. If you'd like to get more videos, show highlights, and watch live event coverage, click on the right over here to subscribe to our channel, and don't forget to download the ABC News app for breaking news alerts. Thanks for watching.